of hearing again and again that there's gonna be peace on earth. Jesus, can you take the time to throw a drowning man a line? Peace on earth. Tell the ones who hear no sound, whose sons are living in the ground. Peace on earth. Know who's the wise, no one cries like a mother cries.
Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who are in distress. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the future, he will honour Galilee of the Gentiles by the way of the sea. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
A thousand years ago, no one thought that it was possible. In Israel, they were besieged by the Assyrians and then the Babylonians. And then 500 years later, they were under Roman occupation. But the heavens would erupt once more, as a host of angels would declare that the time had come, the time for the promise to be delivered had come. So as we make sense of this promise and celebrate Christmas, let's stand and sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
By height and not o'er.
Please be seated. Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to All Saints, to our 11 p.m. Christmas Eve service. It is great to see you all here, and it's great to hear all our singing voices, especially at this time of year as we sing these Christmas carols and as we celebrate the fulfillment of God's promises, especially his promise to bring peace, peace on earth. And that's what we're going to be doing tonight, reflecting on that theme of peace, a theme that could not be any more fitting for us to reflect on, whether it be the peace that we long in our personal lives, or the peace that we long for in our communities, or the peace that we long for across the world. And at Christmas time, we get to see God's peace resting on earth in his Son, Jesus. Well, as we begin our time together, it's important that we pray to our great God, the one who brings peace. And so I'm going to lead us in prayer as we pray for peace in our world. So please join me as I pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this evening, you, the God of all peace and comfort. Father, we thank you that at Christmas time you sent your Son Jesus into the world, the Prince of Peace. And thank you for the hope that we have because of your promise in sending him. Father, at this time we pray that you would pour out your peace on our community, on our country, and across the world. Lord, we pray for our community here in the Shoalhaven. Lord, amidst all the brokenness, addictions, and pain, we ask for your healing hand. We pray that the light of the gospel would shine into the darkness of our community and that we would find our true hope in the Lord Jesus. And Father, for our nation, we ask that you would be merciful. We ask for peace in our families, in households, in workplaces, and amongst people of different ethnic groups. We pray that no matter our backgrounds or our ethnicity, that as our country, that as a country, we will be marked by peace and not hostility. And Lord, we pray for our world. We pray that peace would break out in many places which desperately need it right now. We pray that there will be a permanent ceasefire in conflicts and that there would be repentance, forgiveness, reconciliation and restoration where it is needed. We ask that people in all places will come under the rule of King Jesus and find their everlasting hope in him. And Father, we pray that we ourselves will have peace, that we will have peace with you and peace with one another. You know our hearts, and we ask that you turn them away from ourselves and towards you. Please give us your strength to walk in the love and peace of our Saviour Christ. And we pray this in his name. Amen. Well, our music team have prepared an item for us to reflect on the theme of peace in our world. This item is called Glory in the Darkest Place. So over the next few minutes, feel free to sit back and reflect on some of these words that our music team will be singing.
Glory, glory. come, O come, Emmanuel. Stand as we lift our voices together.
O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, that dwells in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear.
Bible reading is from Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 21. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favour rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. On the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise the child, he was named Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he was conceived.
So that the world may know peace is the whole reason for the Christmas story. And I don't normally open with my punchline, but after this year, I think we can all agree peace has been hard enough to find. So I'm not looking to waste your time with clever wordplay or metaphors. I just know we need hope more than ever before. Because unlike ever before, you can literally read never-ending hurt on Facebook posts and in Twitter feeds. And almost every week, it seems we create another hashtag headstone, followed up by arguments with no regard to just how hard Christmas is gonna be for a family in that home on this year. So many protests welling up out of passionate fear, filling the streets over political people we will never meet. I see people placing their hope in promises that we all know won't keep, and still, the news grows increasingly bleak with stories of tragedy after catastrophe. Rumors of economic shatterings, a drug epidemic no one's talking about, because we traded truth for substitutes and they ain't really working out. So I think if the world is to ever know peace, there couldn't be a better time than now. In this Christmas season where we can run back to that sacred account, it's been echoed for ages on end, a prophecy of a holy God to struggling sinful men that says in order for the world to know peace, a child must be born. And to us a son will be given. The prophecy then states the government will be his alone for the lifting. His names will be Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and our Prince of Peace. As for the greatness of his government and peace within, they say there will be no end to it. Absolutely no finite measurement. Such a promise as this held all of creation in breathlessness for over 700 years without a single shred of evidence. But then on a midnight clear in Bethlehem, a star proclaimed God was finally with men. It was the first recorded Christmas held in a dirty, dirty stable where God incarnate laid as a baby in the manger. All of heaven sang of a savior and shepherds came with tears bigger than Cubs fans in November. The world's first time with Christ is why we celebrate every December, my friends. I'll say it again, that the world may know peace is the real reason for Christmas. This isn't a ploy to make you forget about pain and reality. It's just so you know my God's in the business of being peace to humanity. So down to earth he came, knowing full well he would have to be pierced for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. He took all of our punishment so we might be free, and by his wounds we might meet peace. I hope you're getting this. Peace isn't found in a feeling. Jesus Christ is peace. And I wrote this just so that you could meet him. Merry Christmas.
Please stand and we'll sing again, "O Come All Ye Faithful." This will be an offertory song.
choirs of angels sing in exaltation. Sing, O ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God in the highest. O come, O come, let us adore Him, Christ the Lord. May, Lord, we greet Thee on this happy morning, Jesus, to Thee be
Our next Bible reading comes from Romans chapter 5, verse 1 to 11. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation.
Thanks, Malia. Good evening, everyone. My name is Jeff. I'm one of the ministers here. And in picking up a theme that Rusdian mentioned, it really is good to sing again. It wasn't so long ago that we couldn't sing. That was taken away from us. Now, I'm not going to sing, I'm not going to do slam poetry, but I am going to refer to a song that U2 recorded some years back. They asked God a difficult question. The song was called Peace on Earth. We played that as our service opened, and the question really was, God, whatever happened to your Christmas promise? And the song is in the style of so many laments that make up so many of the Psalms in the Bible, expressing frustration and disappointment. Peace on earth. We need it now. We're sick of all this hanging around. Jesus, can you take the time to throw a drowning man a line? Peace on earth. We hear it every Christmas time, but hope and history won't rhyme. So what's it worth, this peace on earth? That's a killer line in a song, isn't it? Hope and history won't rhyme. Hope is the message of the angels that raises our hopes for world peace, but history is the reality of the wars that have followed ever since. smoking battlefields, horrendous war crimes, genocides, theft of life, livelihood, and family and environment. Did you know that over the last 3,400 years of human history, human beings have been only at peace for some 268 years? That's less than 10% of our recorded history of the world. That is such a tiny piece of peace. So it's a fair question to ask, isn't it? What's it worth, God? This promise of yours, this Christmas promise. Well, there's every chance that the shepherds misheard the whole thing. Maybe the angel said, "Let there be peas on earth," the promise of this little green legume that would bring joy to children at dinner time all around the world, that would give delight to the Englishman so he could mash them up, mushy peas with his pie. I'm sorry, Tim. No, it wasn't peas on earth. And seriously, if we're disappointed in God's apparent lack of delivery for peace on earth, it would only be fair if God asked us, "What is wrong with you people? Why do you continually murder each other for power and control? And what is it that you expect from me? Some kind of magic?" And it's that question that God may well ask us, except that he already knows the answer, that provides us some clues to the answer to the U2 question. So I want to give you three ideas to consider on Christmas Eve. Firstly, God's promise must be understood in light of what's wrong with us. Secondly, we mustn't confuse angels with fairies, okay? And thirdly, we need to hear the complete promise, not just the headline. So firstly and simply, God's promise must be understood in light of what is wrong with us, because newsflash, the heart of the problem is us. Oh, we can be amazing, created in God's image, but we can just be awful, horrendous. Something's gone wrong with us. Secondly, we mustn't confuse angels with fairies. Commercial Christmas is into all kinds of things like talking snowmen and flying reindeer and a man in a red suit who knows whether we've been naughty or nice and flies around the world in a single night delivering toys down a chimney. Have you ever thought about how he fits down those chimneys? Very portly fellow. But the thing is, we've got to make sure we don't mistake fairies and angels. Fairies did not appear to shepherds to sprinkle some sort of fairy dust over the world, some kind of magic called peace, or to turn us into happy zombies. Angels simply means messenger. Angels brought good news, but not magic. And then thirdly, we need to hear the complete promise. Glory to God and peace on earth on whom his favour rests. Now break that down. Glory to God means God was going to do something never witnessed, never imagined before on this earth that would bring him glory, but would bring transformation and peace, but not for everyone. We've got to hear that clause, on whom God's favour rests. It's a very important grammar clause. It ain't no Santa Claus. God would do this amazing thing and it would be freely offered to all people. It would be big enough for all people, but not all people would accept it. In fact, most don't. So hold those three thoughts. God's promise must address the problem with us. God's promise is not magical fairy dust, and God's promise would not actually rest on all people, only those who receive him. And I do want to take a couple of moments more to talk about our problem, our great longing and how God's great promise fulfills both of those things. So I think our great problem is best illustrated tonight in the Middle East and Eastern Europe, where people are firing rockets at each other, groaning under war. And our great problem is best narrated in the Bible's opening chapters in language that might kind of feel strange to our ears, but has been written very poetically and powerfully in Genesis 3. That in the perfect environment that God created, our parents, Adam and Eve, suspected that God was holding out on them. God was holding back the good life, and that they could do better if they made their own rules. That's Genesis 3. Now, little-known singer-songwriter Taylor Swift, she has a very cute song about a couple setting up their first home, and she says, we can leave the Christmas lights on till January. This is our place. We make the rules. You heard that song? Oh, really? And when Taylor Swift sings it, it's really adorable. But when Adam and Eve said to God, this is our place, we make the rules, it was a declaration of war. And the word for this rebellion in Genesis is descriptively the fall or the curse. And we sing it when we sing Joy to the World. No more let sins and sorrows grow, nor thorns infest the ground. He comes to make his blessings flow far as the curse is found. Far as the curse is found. And so in Genesis 3, this curse, this is our place, we make the rules, explains the state of things today. Every generation, every individual has declared war on God, whether they realize it or not. You have. I have. And the next 11 chapters of Genesis just describe how evil spreads like a disease. Now, it was only a few years ago that we all lived through the introduction and spread of COVID throughout the world. And initially, we responded with horror, didn't we? And fear. Something terrible has gone wrong. But now most of us just live with it. And we say it's changed our lives, but we'll be fine. We'll be fine. We'll be fine seems to be the human answer to everything, and it's the answer to the great problem of evil. We'll be fine. It'll change us, but we'll work it out. Thing is, mankind is constantly at war in marriages, families, and communities, and nations, and with the planet, but most of all with God. And our answer? We'll be fine. Is there any wonder that the world has only known peace for 268 years? We're not fine. Nobody I know thinks that we're fine. And war in the Ukraine tonight and over Gaza tonight tells us that we're not fine. And there are as many reminders in this town as there are letterboxes that we're not fine. We have a great problem, and the worst part of this curse is the sting of death. Mortality. Mortality is the result of us saying to God, this is our place, we make the rules. And we need to be clear that death is God's judgment on a world that is at war with him. And if that sting of death is in our bodies, we need more than just moral improvement, don't we? We need to be saved. We need a saviour. Now, while war with God is our great problem, it's also true that we have a great longing. Deep within us is a longing for peace. With our neighbours, with our families, with our spouses, with the environment with God. And this longing was captured powerfully back on a Christmas Eve in 1914. That's a beautiful chalk drawing that Pip down at Hyper did. It's out the front. You can find that there tomorrow if you go for a coffee, if they're open. And it is from a famous photo that on Christmas Eve, 1914, on the Somme, everything was frozen, except for the mud in the trenches. And on those front lines, sometimes the trenches between enemy were only 300 yards apart. And every dreadful day, they exchanged gunfire and they exchanged obscenities with each other. They were just at rock bottom. But on Christmas Eve, the Germans began singing Christmas carols. And eventually, a soldier called out, "Tomorrow, you no shoot, we no shoot." And on Christmas morning, British and German soldiers crawled out of those muddy trenches, put down their weapons, and enemies shook hands and sang Christmas songs together. Silent night drifted across that horrifying battlefield. And for a short time, there was peace. Football matches were played between enemies. It was a glimpse of peace in one of the most bloody and brutal scenes in world history. For a single day, ironically Christmas Day, the great human longing broke ranks and broke out. Isn't that amazing? Finally, the high command on both sides ordered everyone back in the trenches and the killing resumed. We long for peace. We're just not very good at it. Which takes us back to Isaiah 9, God's great promise, big enough to satisfy our great problem and our great longing. It was announced by Isaiah some, 2,500 years ago, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." The promise was of a king in the human line of David, but this prince was also the Everlasting Father, which meant God was coming himself to do something greater than magic, to get his hands bloodied, taking our sins on himself to bring forgiveness, to declare peace. Not magic, a miracle. A miraculous three-part movement, incarnation, from heaven into human history. Salvation to the cross for our forgiveness. Resurrection from death to life to be that everlasting king. The creator of the world moves towards his enemies to make peace with us. This is no fairy dust sprinkling story. It's the sprinkling of blood. And the book of Hebrews says that we've been cleansed by the sprinkling of Jesus' blood shed at the cross. So Romans 5, verse 10, "For if when we were God's enemies," God says "we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life?" The promise of peace with God is to those on whom his favor rests, on those who will receive him. So I guess if the promise of peace turns out to be personal peace with God, is there any hope for world peace? Well, it could be if all people made peace with God first receive Jesus as king, but most won't. Most will resist him and continue the struggle for control and power all the way to the end of history, saying, "We'll be fine." But there will come a day when the Prince of Peace returns to judge the world and will reign forever with those who have received him as king. Are you ready for that day? Because I'll tell you, Christmas is a great time to make peace with God. And I also want to say that if God has kept his promise by giving us Jesus, he can be trusted to keep four other great promises. 2 Peter calls these the great and precious promises. Firstly, to those who believe in his name, he gives the right to become children of God. That's from 1 John, eternal life. Secondly, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. 2 Corinthians 5, it's a complete reset. Who doesn't want that? Thirdly, he says, "I will never leave or forsake you." Hebrews 13, a faithful friend. And fourthly, he promises to return. "I will come back and take you to be with me." John 14. So as we close and as we invite Christmas morning in, I want to invite you to receive the promise of peace, to make Jesus king, make peace with God, and take hold of his great and precious promises. And our Father, we pray that you would turn our emotions, our intellects, our will toward you. And we pray that we would receive you as king and accept everything that Jesus has done for us on the cross, our Prince of Peace. Amen.
Long lay the world in bleak midwinter pining, from Adam's fall declining, sorrow mining, hope resigning, yet this song to heaven inclining. Come, O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel. Descend and all our dark dispel, be pleased as man with man to dwell. This countdown to the first Noel, they did foretell, the prophets preached Emmanuel. God with us, come to break the spell. So low within that manger lies he who built the starry skies. Surprise, that's God with us, the royal son, the second of the three in one. Three is first when counting down, the Father, Son, and Spirit bound, before all things behind above, a unity, joy, hope, and love. Then sent by love and filled with joy, God's hope became a baby boy. See him lying on a bed of straw, the little Lord Jesus, whom angels adore. And all will surely ask, what for? When Adam's ruin beckoned, God sent down a second. Word of the Father now in flesh appearing. Christ was volunteering, human nature commandeering. Adam's life he would redo. This, the meaning of the two. The second of the three became the second of humanity, and he would do it right, and bear our wrongs, and take our curse where it belongs, and rise again like morning sun, and ask us all, will you be one? What child is this, shares our abyss, that we might share in all that's his, made one with us, that we might be united for eternity? So joy to the world, the Lord is come. Good tidings sing in 3, 2, 1.
As you came in tonight, you would have found on your seat this little brochure. You may have found a candle as well. If you found a candle, you can put that in your pocket. And as far as this goes, I don't want you to do anything with this tonight other than put it in your pocket, your handbag or wherever you keep your stuff. Take it home and have a good read of it over Christmas. And in it, you'll find a little card, can't miss it, 321. And it's about a course that we're running in January. Starts January the 2nd, runs for 4 Tuesday evenings. And it's for those who are a little bit curious about who Jesus is and about Christianity. And I think you'll find it very worthwhile to come along. So let us know in our church office that you'd like to be a part of 321 and find out more about peace with God. But it's nearly Christmas morning, so why don't we come up, we sing Joy to the World, band.
Please stand and lift your voices with us as we're welcoming Christmas Day, singing Joy to the World.
This is fun.